How's it going, everybody? My name is Scott Moss, and welcome to Intro to Next.js. In this course, we're going to cover everything you need to know to get started with the latest version of Next.js. Some of the newer features that have come to the scene are pages, layouts, server components, client components, server actions. Honestly, there's just so many to list. I can't wait for you to dive in and check it out yourself. I know by the end of this course, you're going to have a strong foundation in which you can leverage to become a Next.js expert. Next.js as a framework is really just about combining a bunch of conventions that do things for you automatically, where it's supposed to feel magical. Some people like that magical feeling. Some people don't like that magical feeling. I personally like the magical feeling when I know what it's doing and I know what the alternative is. So one of the magical things that they do is that they just hook up the router for you. So you don't have to go figure out and download or even configure a router. You just make files and folders and it's done. So how does that work? Well, it's all based off the file system and the structure inside of our app directory. So basically every single folder that you make in the app directory is going to correspond to a different segment in your router for your app. So an example would be if we had, you know, slash app, and then we had slash dashboard, then slash settings, that's going to make a route for our website.com/dashboard/settings. And then to actually create a page that loads up on that segment, all we have to do is create a page component. So a page.js or page.jsx or page.tsx, just a page. It has to be called page. If you've used the previous version of Next, this wasn't the case. So if you use the pages directory, any file that you made in a folder was going to be that route. That's not the case here. And in this case, you actually specifically have to call it page in order for it to be a page in that segment. So let's check that out. We already have one. If you look in the app directory, there's a page right on the root. So seeing how this page file is on the root, that means its path is just slash. So this will be the home page, right? And we couldn't make another page TSX or JSX or JS in this folder because we couldn't have two home pages and we couldn't have two files with the same names here. So you kind of got to think through how you're working through those conflicts. But let's say we want to make another route here. So let's make a new folder. And we'll call it, docs, because we're going to have a docs section where we talk about the docs for our API. So I can say docs, and then I can go in here, and then I can say page.tsx. And all I have to do is just export a component that that returns some JSX, right? So I'm just going to say const docs page. And I'm just going to make sure that's a default export. Right. And then inside of here, I'm just going to return, inside of here, I'm just going to return a div that just says docs page. Right. So now we have our docs page. And now without having to stop or start anything, I can go right into the browser. I can go into our app. I can say docs and I get my docs page. And that's all I had to do to make a new route. Very simple, very easy. I didn't have to research a router. I didn't have to learn the router. I didn't have to install the router, set it up. I just made a new file, a new folder and a new file. That was it. It's free. Well, let's go take a look at the layout TSX that we have here and the app that was generated for us. And if you ever used the earlier version of Next.js, you probably are asking, so where does the app file go? Where I write the app template if I want to do something globally for the entire app. Where's the root at, basically? Well, layouts kind of serve that purpose. So a layout, like I said earlier, is just a component that wraps other layouts and other pages, right? It's like, I have some common functionality, typically UI, sometimes data, that I want for every single route underneath this layout. So I'm just going to, create a component that does this. In fact, this was such a highly requested feature. If you go back and look at the older version of Next.js and you find the part where they talk about layouts, they basically say, well, here's how you do it yourself because we don't support it. And this is like, and it's never a really good solution. It's just like, they're all just trade-offs. Now they figured it out, how to do that. The other biggest complaint was in the older version of Next.js, you could only do data fetching in pages, but if you need to do data fetching in a layout, let's say your layout was navigation on the left, navigation on top. And on the top, there was like you had to show the user's avatar. So you had to do some type of fetching to get the user's information here. But if that was in a layout, you couldn't do it on the server side because layouts couldn't do data fetching. So it was like you had to do all this weird workaround in order to get this to work. But now that's not the case. You can do, you know, layouts are treated just like pages. They are first class citizens. They can do data fetching and they allow you to share UI. So one rule you have to have in Next.js app router is that you have to have a root layout. But there's many ways you can do it. One way you can do it is the way that we see here, as in there is a layout file immediately in the root of the app file. And this is the root layout. This is like the app.js or JSX or TSX that you would have had in the previous version of Next.js. It's where your whole app gets rendered into. So you kind of need this. So you can see I'm actually using the HTML tag here and the body, and then everywhere where you see children, that's where the pages get rendered, right? So the pages get rendered here. This is also a great place to do anything global. Like I have some global CSS, you know, some font stuff going on here. Don't worry about this metadata thing. We'll talk about that. But essentially it's just a function. It's just a component that can do whatever it wants and it renders its children, which are gonna be pages. That's it.
Is this a case where root layout is a specially namespaced magic keyword, or it could be like export default function foobar?
Oh yeah, so this name is irrelevant. You can call this whatever you want. Yeah, this is just what they generated with when we did the create next app. But yeah, there is no convention around the name of a component in Next.js. You can call it whatever you want. I just prefer to keep it capital. But yeah, this name doesn't mean anything. You can call this literally anything. But it is a layout. You can see that, you know, we got some CSS here. We got our classes. We're wrapping our children. And as far as like the children, where does this come from? Well, if you look at layout, are there any routes that are children of this layout? As in, are there any folders that are next to it? Yeah, so that means everything in docs, everything in dashboard is gonna be rendered here and any pages next to it. So this includes this page here, right? And just to illustrate that, I can just move this down a little bit and I can just say, you know, layouts like this, right? And then I can put the children here. So once I put layout there and I go back to our app, there's always going to be layout, right? Oh, that's huge. Oh, there's layout right there. It's always going to be here because it's part of the entire app. It's always here. The other sweet thing about layout is that even though the route changes, the layout never re-renders. It is cached. It doesn't re-render or re-evaluate when you change a route. It stays the same, which is so great for something like a UI. And if you had to do some of this on your own in the previous version of Next, trying to make sure that doesn't re-render was always a pain. Like you had to do like, you know, memos and it was always a pain to try to do that stuff yourself. So now it doesn't. Layouts just don't re-render. They will always stay on the page no matter what route you go to, which is pretty useful. And then you can have nested layouts, right? So back to our route grouping example, if I wanted my dashboard to have a specific layout to it that my landing page wouldn't have, I would add that here, right? So in this case, I do. My dashboard is probably gonna look different than my landing page would. So I'm gonna add a new layout here in the dashboard group folder. So I'm gonna make a new file and I'm gonna call it layout.tsx. I can make a new dashboard layout. Right, and it's just a function that we do, that we export. And the only thing about layouts, you can do whatever you want. You just need to make sure you render the children. Because if you don't render the children, they'll never show through. It'll just only show your layout. So just be sure to do that. So you always want to make sure you have your children. Prop, you know, return your div. I'm going to put an H1 here that says dashboard. And a div that has my children. Like that. So now I have my dashboard layout. Now any children here should be anything that's sibling to this layout, which I don't have, and anything that's a child of it, which in case it is this to-dos. So if I go to slash to-dos, I should see this dashboard load up as well. So let's try that. There we go. So you can see here's the root layout, which nests the dashboard layout, which renders this page. Right? So that's how we're able to nest layouts, because they just reside in folders underneath each other. As a refresher, server components are components that run on the server. They literally execute in the node environment, which means you can do node things. The other thing, though, that you might have thought about, and maybe you didn't know this is how this worked, but because they only execute on the server and they're not in like React's context of change detection and virtual DOM and all that stuff, they don't opt into the same behavior as a regular React component. Do you know what happens when you update a state from a state hook in a React component? Like, what happens to that component? Anybody want to guess? Or why do we even need hooks in the first place? Like, what is that?
To render it again with updated data?
Yeah, exactly. When you call that update state function, it does render the component again with updated data. But like, what does it mean to render again, right? Like, if you really think about it, this looks like a regular JavaScript function, but one, you never call this function, right? React calls the function for you, so that's one thing. And you have no control over when it gets called, because its parent might re-render, which causes this to re-render, right? You don't really get that much control. Yeah, you can use things like memo and stuff like that to prevent it from re-rendering, but that's because this isn't just like an ordinary JavaScript function. Like, you ever try to put async in front of this and see what happens? You can't async await anywhere inside of here, right? That's because this entire function, it needs to return, you know, synchronously needs to return some type of JSX, right? You cannot block that rendering process. You will get an error. So how do you do things that are async? Well, that's where hooks come along. This is a long way of saying with server components, none of this matters. You can just forget about it. This is just regular React. That's how client components work. Server components they're just regular functions. They're really just regular functions that return HTML that just use JSX at this point. So because of that, when it comes to something like data fetching or something like that, we can do whatever we would normally do to fetch data in a normal function, which is really cool. So let's talk about that. So for instance, if I wanted to grab some data from this, you know, some data in this homepage, let's say that data was async data. So I'm going to make this function an async function. And I wanted to get some data. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to make a function that says get data. Right? It's going to make a function that says get data. And it's going to be an async function. And then I'm just going to await a new promise. I'm just going to make a delay here so we can be dramatic about it. I'm just going to do a set timeout of some time or something like that. And it's just going to resolve here, after some time of like, let's say 2 seconds. So it's just going to do that. And then it's going to return some data, right? And then it'll say, cool, here's some data. Here's your data, right? So now I can go in here and say, cool, give me my data, and I can await that. You've never been able to do this in React. Never been able to do async await inside of a component. Couldn't do it because of the reasons I just showed you. It has to be synchronous. It has to return some JSX. It's not going to keep track of stuff. You got these hooks if you want to do things. And that's just because how React does reconciliation and, you know, keeping the render cycle clean. Imagine if React had to wait for your component to get some data before it could render it. Your app would be so slow, no one would ever use it. It wouldn't work, right? Okay, but on the server, it's cool, it's fine, it doesn't matter. So now I can do that and I can get the data and I can do whatever I want with the data, right? So you can use that data, I'm just gonna log it. All right, so now I can just log that data like that. I don't know, I'm just gonna do it this way. This is how I do it anyway. There we go, and then export default home. So now we can wait it for like 2 seconds. We can await this data, we can log it, and then we can kind of see what happens. So you can see it's already taken longer. That took 2 seconds. And then you can see the data is here on the server side. So it's not logging here in the console in the browser, right? Because it's server side. So it's gonna log here in a terminal. I made a new to-do, and we know we're pulling all the to-dos on this page. We saw it was an empty array. Why is it not there? Well, if I just refresh, there you go, it shows up now on the page. But why do I have to refresh after I save that? That's kind of gross, right? Like, we want that just to pop up immediately. And this is why I said server actions are really great for mutations, because if you need the UI to be updated after you perform a server action, it's not as simple. You don't get that for free as you would waiting for a response on an HTTP call where you can like, I'm just going to await this fetch and then get the result and then do whatever I want with the result, or even do an optimistic update. You could do all of that with server actions. You could do optimistic updates. It's a lot harder. But at that point, you're writing client-side code. You need client-side code to do optimistic updates. So why not just use a client-side fetch? But for now, we're going to get around all of that by tapping into the revalidation functionality. So if you look at the page in which needs to be updated, whenever this server action is created, it's going to be slash to-dos, right? We want slash to-dos to refetch its data, because what is it doing on load? It's getting all the to-dos. So we want to revalidate. This page is cached right now. So we want to tell Next.js like, hey, after we perform the server action, revalidate this page, which will then like tell it to go fetch its data. So that's what we want to do after our server action. So let's do that. So we can go into our action. And right after we do this, we can just say, yeah, just do a revalidate right quick, revalidate path for slash to-dos. And you could think of this as like a soft refresh. It's not going to refresh the page, but it's going to expire the cache of that page, which then forces it to go refetch its data. So let's do that. So now when I add a new to-do, you know, clean my room, it shows up on the page without me refreshing. And that's because we did a server action on a server that changed something in the database. We waited for that to happen. And then we told Next.js, delete the cache for this page slash to-dos, which then made it go fetch its own data all over again, which then got an array of two to-dos and put them on the page.